This is Universal Studios, one of the largest and busiest motion picture and television studios in the world. Join us on our guided tour and see how the excitement and magic of movies are created. Our glamour tram is loading, and we're about to set out on a journey into fantasy and adventure. Our tour guide is Julie. Here's a good bird's eye view of Universal's fabulous back lot, where we're going to get a close-up look at what goes on behind the scenes in movie land. What's that blocking our path? I guess we must be filming up here.
Halt, foolish humans. You have blundered into a Cylon battle zone. You are now our prisoners. Move forward immediately.
I really don't think we should go inside that spaceship. On second thought, maybe we should.
This group of very strange-looking Earth creatures has been captured while attempting a sneak attack on our battleship.
Foolish mortals, your fate is sealed. What is the standing order of your imperious leader?
By your command, the total extermination of the life form known as man.
A position here has been discovered. More humans may follow. Prepare for liftoff.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6.
In the name of the 12 colonies of man, I demand the release of the humans. I'll be all right.
Thanks to our brave colonial warrior, we've just survived the Battle of Galactica. It's not every day that you need to be rescued from alien invaders firing laser guns. There's a house on fire! Actually, it isn't really burning. The flames are real enough, of course, but no part of the house will ever catch fire. It's just a good example of movie special effects, and only one of many we're going to see on our studio tour. We're headed down to Universal's front lot, among the huge sound stages where indoor filming is done. There are 35 of these giant buildings here. The largest is about the size of a football field. But our first stop is a small bungalow. The lady won a whole shelf full of Academy Awards during her illustrious career. For over 40 years, Edith Head was the movie's foremost costume designer. Fashions from several of her films, including The Sting, are on display, and we've reconstructed her design studio here. Our next stop is the special effects stage, presented by Eastman Kodak Company. This is where the magic really starts, and you'll see how important imagination is in the making of a motion picture. Back in the 30s, when both movies and audiences were a little less sophisticated than they are now, a model like this was used for Buck Rogers' spaceship. Yeah. It sailed through the galaxy, trailing sparks and smoke, and everyone was sure this was what the craft should look like. In Battlestar Galactica and other recent space adventure films, the hardware was a lot more sophisticated. Nobody's ever seen a dinosaur, but these highly detailed models are built on articulated frameworks so they can be moved and filmed, one frame at a time, in a very convincing prehistoric fight scene. But realism isn't always the goal of the special effects people. Sometimes they just like to surprise us. In his comedy extravaganza, 1941, director Steven Spielberg made extensive use of elaborate miniatures like this amusement park, with its hundreds of tiny light bulbs. After some complex optical work in the laboratory, the model of this craft will appear to glide through the depths of space. Only in the more recent versions of his adventures did Buck Rogers travel in such first-class fashion. Our actors here, by the way, are members of our own tour group. On board the Glamour Tram again, we resume our tour of the studio. We travel right through the main prop warehouse. It's over an acre in size and contains more than 5 million props, the largest collection in the industry. This is the back lot, where we do much of our exterior filming. Here on Brownstone Street, many movie scenes of city life have been shot, including Lady Sings the Blues and The Sting, which won the Oscar for Best Picture in 1973. Nearby, New York Street stood in for Los Angeles in Earthquake. And for East Berlin in Torn Curtain. It was New York in the 20s in Thoroughly Modern Millie. We covered over this entire section of the back lot with black plastic sheeting for all of the night scenes in Streets of Fire. I'm really sorry we have to go over that old bridge. I worry every time we cross. It's never been very sturdy, and now it looks like it's falling apart. I guess I should tell you that this bridge isn't old at all. It was built in 1974, and thanks to the good work of our special effects people, it collapses right on cue and then puts itself back together again for the next tram. We'll have a short rest stop here at Prop Plaza. Good place to stretch your muscles and take a few pictures. You'll see some giant props here from The Incredible Shrinking Woman and other movies. We resume our tour on the glamour tram just in time to get caught in a rainstorm. Hollywood style, of course. Look! It's a flash flood! But even the falling tree is a part of the animation act. Our flood is created when 10,000 gallons of water are released from huge tanks on the hill above. The water will be pumped back up to the tanks again in about 90 seconds and ready whenever the next flash flood may be called for. Stable where Mae West rescued W.C. Fields from the lynch mob in My Little Chickadee is still here. And so is part of the hanging rope. These buildings are among the oldest standing sets on the lot. We call this area Six Points because six separate streets meet here. Originally, each street represented a complete western town with its own bank, sheriff's office, and saloon. In the days of silent movies, we could film six different Western epics here, all at the same time. Tom Mix, Hoot Gibson, John Wayne, and Jimmy Stewart all made Western movies on these streets. For Shenandoah in 1965, we had crowds of extras here. We never actually made a survey, but we think this is probably the skinniest church in the world. There's a submarine. Wonder if it's one of ours. Huh. Certainly seems to be tracking us. But this is crazy. Whoever heard of a sub torpedoing one of Universal's glamour trams? But look! They've launched a torpedo right at us! Well, they missed us. But take my word for it, our problems aren't over yet. Now our road is blocked by water. But since this is Universal's version of the Red Sea, we should probably get busy and part it. Cecil B. DeMille went to a lot more trouble than this when he parted the Red Sea. Not once, but twice, in Paramount's two versions of the Ten Commandments, in 1923 and 1956. Behind us, just the way they're supposed to. Now you can say the Red Sea has parted for you, and you got through it without getting wet at all. In this section of the back lot, everything looks slightly foreign, and deliberately so. This is Little Europe. Changing the shop signs, props, and automobiles, we can turn this area into a small village in almost any European country. Both Frankenstein's monster and Dracula terrorize the townspeople here. All Quiet on the Western Front, the Academy Award-winning film of 1929, and dozens of other movies and TV programs have been shot in part on these cobblestone streets. We'll have to stop for the train, but that's... Hey, we're not stopping. We're going to race it. Ah, Amity Island. The name sounds so pleasant. Things will surely be a little more peaceful here, in this quiet village on the coast of New England. But I'd feel guilty if I didn't tell you that this is the town of Amity, which was terrorized by that ferocious great white shark in Jaws, one of the industry's all-time top moneymakers. We've been trying to catch the shark, but I'm afraid he's still here, somewhere. There he is. Hey, look out! It looks like we may be next. Once the famous home of the Munsters, a popular TV series of a few seasons back. We're entering Colonial Street. All these houses look very real until you discover that they're just shells, or even just facades, that are used for exterior filming only. This is a nice neighborhood. At one time or another, for movies or TV, Doris Day, Beaver Cleaver, Dr. Marcus Welby, The Hardy Boys, and, years ago, Deanna Durbin all lived here. Probably our most famous resident was the star of Bedtime for Bonzo, Ronald Reagan. Looming ominously against the sky is the dark and frightening house used in Alfred Hitchcock's Psycho, a perfect set for the master of suspense to film in his own disturbing and very special way. The same house was used again in the recent sequel, Psycho 2. I bet you didn't realize it, but we've been climbing steadily. The elevation here is over 10,000 feet, by far the highest point on the lot. The only way we can get safely through the glacier on the other side of the mountain here is via the ice tunnel ahead. This road is often closed by avalanches, so we'll have to be careful. end of the tunnel. Looks like we're going to make it after all. We began offering tours as long ago as 1919. These scenes were shot in the 20s when, apparently, not everyone found a seat on the trams. President of Universal Studios then had bleachers set up so tourists could watch movies being made. The coming of sound changed all that, and the tours were discontinued. Universal revived them in the early 60s. The studio was big and busy even in those early days, producing comedies and dramas and westerns that thrilled and delighted audiences all over the world. We look a lot different today, but we like to think we're still doing that exact same thing. Where we'll get off the tram is the newly enlarged Universal Amphitheater. This theater draws capacity crowds in the evening when superstars of the entertainment world appear here in concert. Up here, near where our tram tour began, is Universal Studios' famous entertainment center. Here you'll find a great variety of exciting shops, restaurants, and live shows. There's a motion picture and television museum exhibiting unusual props and memorabilia from historic films of Hollywood's past. These are rare items you'll see nowhere else. In the case of this little guy, that's just as well. The collection of priceless old movie cameras is unique. In our Screen Test Comedy Theater, we present one of the wackiest and funniest chase scenes ever concocted. We cast about 35 people right out of the audience to play starring roles. The show begins with a bank robbery in the Old West. Escape, and our camera crew films them riding mechanical horses while painted scenery unrolls behind them. From this point on, the plot becomes so hopelessly complex it defies summarizing. The bad guys are cornered and jump into a river, taking with them the carpet bag that contains their loot. To bring you a spectacular production. And along with our leaky rowboats and acrobatic airplanes, you're sure to see some first-class comic talent. A taped version of the whole hilarious caper is shown to the audience on TV monitors in the theater. The show ends with a custard pie fight of classic proportions. Stage presents the remarkable talents of a large cast of birds, chimps, and dogs. The people who work behind the motion picture cameras are sometimes presented with some very challenging problems, and that applies especially to the people who work with animals. Their talents aren't required just for gentle animals like cats and dogs. Often a movie story will require trained lions or bears or even snakes. All of us who love animals respond to the obvious affection that exists between these actors and the dedicated men who work with them. Our stunt show is presented by real movie stuntmen who demonstrate how fistfights are choreographed and staged. We see a rawhide whip used by an expert, just as it might be done in a Western, with the good guy versus the bad guy. When the cowboy in the quicksand asks for a rope, his buddy gives it to him. Although these superb action scenes are presented in a Western setting, comparable stunt work may be needed for almost any kind of film, from horror movies to romances to space adventures. Universal Studios is proud to present a spectacular sword and sorcery show inspired by the blockbuster film Conan the Barbarian, starring Arnold Schwarzenegger. We have wizards and warriors, stalwart heroes and brave heroines, all mounted in one of the most astonishing stage presentations ever. We combine gymnastics and swordplay with pyrotechnics and lasers and, well, just wait till you see our dragon! Conan and Red Sonja have triumphed over evil, as everyone hoped they would. Here and elsewhere at Universal Studios, we've had a glimpse behind the scenes of Hollywood. The fun and excitement we've had here are all part of the best entertainment on earth, the magic of the movies.